And what I'm going to be covering this afternoon is, obviously we know salvation's by grace through faith. There's no disputing that. There's no arguing that. And people who even believe in works will give lip service to that as well. No one really wants to contradict salvation's by grace through faith, unless you're in a cult, like a, you know, Jehovah's False Witness or something like that. Then they'll say, no, 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 you absolutely have to have works, and they don't mind just saying it out loud. But one of the problems in modern Christianity, I think even among many people who are believers, who truly are believers in Jesus Christ, is where does the law fit in to the life of someone who's a believer? Where is it? How is it that we should, you know, the Bible's very clear right here that it's not of the works of the law. It has nothing to do with the law. We're actually free from the law. And you'll hear people sometimes say, hey, man, I'm free in Christ. Now, that's great. We're free in Christ, right? What are we free from? We're free from the curse of the law. But one thing that we need to be careful about and watch out for is the people who think that basically the law just doesn't apply anymore at all because we're in the New Testament and because we're saved, that basically you could just do whatever you want and there's not a problem with that. Now, the Bible teaches very different than that. And we're going to see that. We're going to look at some of the verses today. We started off with Galatians chapter 3. Galatians 3 is an awesome chapter, especially for preaching the gospel to someone. Galatians 2, Galatians 3, you could show people that are hung up on works that it's not of works. But one of the places that people will turn to then to say that, oh, well, we don't need to follow the law anymore is Galatians 3, could be a passage that they would use. But let's reread some of this. Let's go back up to verse number 16. The Bible says, now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not in the seeds as of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of God in Christ, the law, which was 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect. So this is explaining that Abraham was given promises, but then the law didn't actually come until 430 years later. It came after that, when Moses gave the law, which is, you know, the Leviticus, Deuteronomy, right? The law of God that was given through Moses. That came after, but he's bringing up the point that, well, Abraham was given these promises before that even ever came. He's explaining that salvation is never through the law. It wasn't through the law. The law doesn't disannul the promise. God made the promise first, and then he instituted law. So he's saying, like, just because you break the law doesn't make that promise of none effect. Just because now you broke a law, you're a sinner, you deserve this punishment because there's this law in place. He say that doesn't nullify the promise that was made. And this is the whole point. So we need to understand what is really being taught, what is being expressed in the passage. Get the whole thing in context instead of just yanking out maybe one verse to try to prop up some whole doctrine on, because they'll prop up a verse that says, you know, we're no longer under the law. And it's like, well, yeah, but what is the context of it talking about? If we, because what they'll try to do is say, well, we're no longer under the law, which means you can't judge me on anything that I do because we're not under the law. We're free in Christ. But that's not the purpose of what these verses are saying. You know, in a sense, it's saying, yeah, you're free from the curse of the law, but it's not saying that you just go ahead and do whatever you want and there's no problem and there's no judgment. Now, there may not be an eternal judgment of spending, you know, eternity in hell, but there's still a problem with saying that, you know, no, you know, you could just do whatever you want and God's fine. And actually, that type of an attitude gives once saved, always saved, what we believe, a bad name. When people just teach and say, oh, you can just do whatever you want. I was just talking to a Pentecostal lady like a week ago that, you know, because this is how it's presented to them, right? They're going to their church and they'll say, oh, this is, you can't believe once saved, always saved, because they just think that you could just live however you want and everything's just fine. And, you know, you could just keep on sin, doing this stuff. And it's a mixed bag when they preach this stuff, because on one hand, well, yeah, you know what? You will still be saved no matter how you live. But on the other hand, it's also not what God is telling you to do, to just live in sin and just who cares and be flippant about it and say whatever. But we're going to see a lot of verses that tell us, you know, should we continue in sin? God forbid. Of course we shouldn't continue in sin. Of course we should live a righteous life. And of course there's consequences for our actions. No, the law is still very much important in the New Testament, just as much as it was in the Old Testament. The law is there. Yea, we establish the law. And that's what the title of the sermon is this morning. Yea, we establish the law.